Blackstone Audio presents. Dancing in the Streets, A History of Collective Joy by Barbara Ehrenreich. To Anna and Clara, you know how to do it. Introduction. Invitation to the dance. When Europeans undertook their campaigns of conquest and exploration in what seemed to them new worlds, they found the natives engaged in many strange and lurid activities. Cannibalism was reported, though seldom convincingly documented, along with human sacrifice, bodily mutilation, body and face painting, and flagrantly open sexual practices. Equally jarring to European sensibilities was the almost ubiquitous practice of ecstatic ritual, in which the natives would gather to dance, sing, or chant to a state of exhaustion, and beyond that sometimes trance. Everywhere they went, among the hunter-gatherers of Australia, the horticulturists of Polynesia, the village peoples of India, white men and occasionally women witnessed these electrifying rites so frequently that there seemed to them to be, among the present societies of savage men, an extraordinary uniformity, in spite of much local variation, in ritual and mythology. The European idea of the savage came to focus on the image of painted and bizarrely costumed bodies, drumming and dancing with wild abandon by the light of a fire. What did they actually see? A single ritual could look very different to different observers. When he arrived in Tahiti in the late 1700s, Captain Cook watched groups of girls performing a very indecent dance, which they call tamoradi, singing the most indecent songs and using most indecent actions. In doing this, they kept time to a great nicety. About 60 years later, Herman Melville found the same ritual, by then called Lori Lori, and perhaps modified in other ways, full of sensual charm. Presently, raising a strange chant, they softly sway themselves, gradually quickening the movement until at length, for a few passionate moments, with throbbing bosoms and glowing cheeks, they abandon themselves to all the spirit of the dance, apparently lost to everything around. But soon subsiding again into the same languid measure as before, the eyes swimming in their heads, join in one wild chorus and sink into each other's arms. Like Captain Cook, Charles Darwin was repelled by the corroboree rite of Western Australians, reporting that the dancing consisted in their running either sideways or in Indian file into an open space, and stamping the ground with great force as they marched together. Their heavy footsteps were accompanied with a kind of grunt, by beating their clubs and spears together, and by various other gesticulations, such as extending their arms and wriggling their bodies. It was a most rude, barbarous scene, and to our ideas without any sort of meaning. But to the anthropologists Baldwin Spencer and Frank Gillen, a similar Aboriginal rite was far more compelling, perhaps even enticing. The smoke, the blazing torches, the showers of sparks falling in all directions, and the masses of dancing, yelling men formed a genuinely wild and savage scene of which it is impossible to convey any adequate idea in words. It was this description that fed into the great French sociologist Emile Durkheim's notion of collective effervescence, the ritually induced passion or ecstasy that cements social bonds and, he proposed, forms the ultimate basis of religion. Through the institution of slavery, European Americans had the opportunity to observe their own captive natives at close range, and they too reported varying and contradictory responses to the ecstatic rituals of the transplanted Africans. Many whites of the slave-owning class saw such practices as noisy, crude, impious, and, simply, dissolute, and took strong measures to suppress them. The 19th-century absentee owner of a Jamaican plantation found his slaves doing a mile dance, probably derived from an initiation rite of the Azandi people of Africa, and described them as engaged in a great variety of grotesque actions, and chanting all the while something between a song and a howl. Similarly, an English visitor to Trinidad in 1845 reported disgustedly that, on Christmas Eve, it seemed as if, under the guise of religion, all pandemonium had been let loose. Drunkenness, bursting forth in yells and bacchanalian orgies, was universal amongst the blacks. Sleep was out of the question in the midst of such a disgusting and fiendish saturnalia. The musicians.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.